Welcome to the live webinar session of Telangana Residential Education Institution Society. This is P. Swajani, PGT in Biology from Burgampad. So very good afternoon, children. So in the previous classes of excretion, you have seen what are the structures which are involved in excretion, especially about the kidney, the structure of kidney and functioning of the kidney, how the kidney works for the filtration of the blood, purification of the blood, and how the formation of urine is going to be happen, what is the composition of urine. All these things we have learned in the previous session. So in this session, we are going to learn. So if the both the kidneys are going to be damaged. So in the previous session, we have asked one question. So whether if both the kidneys are going to be damaged, is any solution for that? So yes, there is a solution we discussed. So here, there is a solution. So that solutions are temporary solution and also the permanent solution. So one of the solution I'm going to discuss for you, and I'm going to share my knowledge regarding all those things. So already you have you completed this, what are the structures which are involved in excretory systems. So excretory system containing the kidneys and all these ureters, urethra, and how these structures are helpful for the formation of urine and also purification of blood in the kidney. So, and also internal structure, also, structure of kidney also you have understood. And so here, what happens if both kidneys fail completely? So what happens if both kidneys are going to fail completely means there are irreversible kidney failure. This results into the that is called end stage renal disease. ESRD. ESRD is called end stage renal disease. So when the complete and irreversible kidney failure is called, that is called end stage renal disease. So at this stage, what will the things can be do for maintaining of the blood in a proper way means the filtration of blood. So what are the procedures we use that we are going to see now? So that dialysis. So dialysis is the process where we can see this dialysis machine is called as artificial kidney. So this is a textbook diagram. You are able to, you can see this. So here what they are going to do is in this process, the blood is purified outside the body, not inside the body. Actually, the human body itself by having the kidneys in the human body, that will helpful for the filtration of the blood. But here, if both the kidneys are going to be damaged, if one kidney is able to maintain the filtration of blood properly, but if the both kidneys are going to be damaged, at that time, the person who are suffering with this ESRD are going to, then they can go for this dialysis techniques. So what is this dialysis? And these dialysis will helpful for the filtration of blood, and how it helpful for the filtration of blood we are going to see now. So in which principle the dialysis works? So hemodialysis. Dialysis is about blood. Hemo means blood. So blood is going to be purified in this process. That's why it is called hemodialysis. Kidneys are vital organs for survival. Several factors like infections, injury, very high blood pressure, very high blood sugar, or restricted blood flow to kidneys. This leads to accumulation of poisonous waste in the body and leads to death. So dialysis machine is used to filter blood of a person when both kidneys are damaged. So this process is called hemodialysis. Purification of blood is going to be happen by using the artificial kidney. The artificial kidney is nothing but here the dialysis machine. So when the hemodialysis should be done, so when the patient is suffering with ESRD, end stage renal disease, so at that time the doctor suggests go for hemodialysis, the artificial kidney. So in the hemodialysis process, you can see from the patient's body. So blood is going to be collected from the patient's body by the artery. So from one of the artery, the blood is going to collected into the machine. So where after collecting, So one blood thinner is going to be injected into that tube. What is this blood thinner? To maintain the purification of blood very easy, the blood thinner is going to be added in this. And next, we have to create a pressure monitor and pump. So in the nephrons, how the pressure is created? That pressure should be created here also to filter the blood. So this pressure monitor is responsible for, is this pressure monitor will do the function of monitoring the pressure, how much pressure we are applying and how it is going to work. So this pressure monitor and pump is going to be attached to this dialysate solution. So this is the chamber, the dialyzer chamber where dialysis solution is going to be present. So after this, the blood is from the patient body, the blood is entered into the dialyzer. The dialyzer where the purification is going to be happen. So from this, after purification, these used dialyzed solutions are going to be pumped out, and the blood which is purified, again it has to be entered into the body of the patient. So here, after purifying the blood, this blood, whatever the purified blood is there, that is again going to be entered into the patient's body. So here, a trap and pressure monitor is to be maintained over here to maintain the pressure and it. So next one is filtered blood returns to our body. So whoever the patient, that patient is again getting the blood which is purified. So what the artificial kidney is doing, the hemodialysis machine is doing the function of purifying the blood. So how it is doing, from the main artery, the blood is going to be taken out through the tubes, and this is going to be maintained on the blood. The pressure is going to be maintained. Due to that, the blood is going to be reached into the dialyzer. In the dialyzer, dialysate solution is to be present. That will helpful for the purification of blood. And after the dialysis process is completed, after the dialyzing the blood, what is going to be done? So the purified blood, the blood without any impurities, are again, they are entering into the patient's body, and the dialyzing fluid, dialysate solution is pumped out of the dialyzer. So this is going to be happen in the hemodialysis process. I think you have understood how the purification of blood is going to be taken place outside the body of a patient. And what does a dialyzer do? So what is the function of the dialyzer? So a dialyzer is the part in the hemodialysis machine where your blood gets filtered. So this is the dialyzer where blood is going to be filtered. So the core of the dialyzer is made up of thousands of tiny mesh tubes. It is with the many mesh tubes. Your blood flows inside each tube and the dialysate stays on the outside of the tube. So the blood flows inside each tube and the dialysate stays on the outside of the tubes. Tiny pores in the tubes let waste and excess fluid pass from your blood into the dialysate. So these pores helpful for the waste materials to enter, and excess fluid pass from your the patient blood into the dialyzer. So now cleaned blood then leaves the dialyzer and it is returned into the patient's body. So this is the process how the dialyzer is going to work. So the dialyzer is the machine from where the purification of blood is going to be taken place by using the tiny mesh-like tubes. In this mesh-like tubes, filtration of the blood is going to be happen. In this process, blood is taken out from the main artery mixed with an anticoagulant. Why we have to mix with an anticoagulant? Blood should not be clotted, no? That's why we are going to use the anticoagulant. So what are the example for anticoagulant is heparin. So, and then pumped into the apparatus called dialyzer. In this apparatus, blood flows to the channels or tubes which are made up of cellophane. So all these processes very, it works on the principle of dilute diffusion process. The principle which the dialyzer works is on the diffusion. Okay, here what they are doing, so blood is taken out from the main artery and it is mixed with the anticoagulant. So our blood thinner is also used, and the example for anticoagulant what we can use is heparin, and then pumped into the apparatus called dialyzer, and it is entered into the dialyzer. And this apparatus, blood flows through the channels or tubes, which are made up of cellophane tubes. These tubes are nothing but tiny meshes we have talked about now. So that is, those are nothing but cellophanes. This is about. So here see that these tubes are embedded in the dialyzing fluid. The membrane separates the blood flowing inside the tube and dialyzing fluid. So after that, what is happened, which has the same compositions as that of plasma, except the nitrogenous vases. So everything is going to be entered other than the nitrogenous vase from the blood. So everything remaining, everything is going to be entered into the body again, as same as composition that of plasma, except the nitrogenous vases are going to be released into the dialyzing fluid. That dialyzing fluid is going pumped out of the dialyzer after purification of blood. So, so it is like same like kidney, but reabsorption is not going to be taken place. So here the clean blood is pumped back to the body through a vein after adding anticoagulant. So each dialysis sessions last for 3 to 6 hours. This method can be used. This method has been using for thousands of uremic or kidney failure patients all over the world. So here it takes 3 to 6 hours time, and the blood is taken out through artery, and the blood, whatever purified again, it will reach, it will pump through a vein. This you have to remember. The blood from the patient body is impurity is present in the arteries, no? So the blood with impurities are present in the oxygenated blood with impurities are present in the arteries, that is going to be taken out, and again the purified blood is going to be entered into the veins. So this lasts for this session, each dialysis session lasts for 3 to 6 hours. So this method has been using for thousands of patients. So is there any long-term solution for kidney failure patients? So this is a short-term process where whenever required, whenever impurities are much, so then we use for this use this dialysis. So if we want every time going to the hospital or at our home also, the dialysis can be taken place if the dialysis machine is there. So every time it is not going to be happened by some of the patients. So for looking after the patient, nobody, if it is there, nobody is available. So at that time, there is a long-term solution for kidney failure patients. What is that? That is nothing but the kidney transplantation. The kidney transplantation is going to be happen when now, this is a long-term solution for the kidney patients, kidney failure patients. So, kidney transplantation. So, what is this kidney transplantation? The best long-term solution for kidney failure. Kidney failure is nothing but acute renal failure. I have discussed about the term renal. Renal is related to kidney. So, where some of the tissues of the kidney, that is nothing but that is associated with the nephrons, are going to be failed. So is kidney transplantation. That process is called kidney transplantation. The functioning kidney is used in transplantation from a donor, preferably a close relative. Why the donor must be a close relative? Why? Because the blood group of the relative, the blood group of the person should be exactly matched to the patient. Otherwise, the rejection of the kidney is going to be happen. Rejection is going to be happen if it is mismatches the rejection. The body of the patient rejects the transplanted kidney. So the patient's immune system reject the transplanted kidney. So that's why close relatives, the donor preferably a close relative. So then it will be exactly matched to the patient. Sometimes it is also not matched. So most of the times the chances are high. So for matching, modern clinical procedures have increased the success rate of such complicated techniques. So by using different techniques, nowadays it is also made a easy process. So this is a kidney transplantation. So here both the kidneys are there, both the kidneys are present. So even though both the kidneys are present, they are not in a state of working. At that time, the kidney transplantation is the permanent solution. So here kidney transplantation has happened. So both the kidneys remains the same at the position and where the transplanted kidney should be placed. So where is the transplanted kidney fixed in the body of a kidney failure patient? So this is a good question, no? So in lower abdomen, just above one of our lower leg. So about here, the lower leg, one of our lower leg, just above one of our lower leg, the kidney is going to be placed. So what about the failed kidneys? Is the failed kidneys remain in the same place or it should be removed? Sometimes it will be removed and sometimes it is in the same position. Why? If infections are more, so what is going to be happen? It should be removed. If infections are less, if there is no infection at that time, it should be placed there itself. So not removed unless it create more problem like BP, high BP and also infections. Okay. Can donor lead normal life with a single kidney without any complications? Yes, donor can live with a single kidney, and the patient who receives the transplanted kidney also can live good, very nice. So that is the reason why kidney transplantation is a permanent solution for the kidney failure patients. So where the kidney has to be placed? So the kidney has to be, the transplanted kidney has to be placed in the lower abdomen, just above one of our lower leg. So what about the failed kidneys? So sometimes, most of the times it is not going to be removed. Only sometimes when the problem, any high risk is there, high BP is there, or any high risk of other infections are there, then at that time it is going to be removed. Can donor lead normal life with a single kidney without any complication? Yes, donor can live normal life. So this organ donation is a boon of kidney patients, not only the kidney patients, the persons who are suffering with the different ailments, means heart failure or some other liver failure. So all these patients are very happy when the organ donation plays a major role in their life. So these organs, from where the organs are going to be collected? So these organs are collected from the brain dead patients. So if anybody has accidentally the brain death is going to be happen at that time, they're remaining every all organs are functioning well, only the brain is not going to be function well. So at that time they go for this organ transplantation. So they their organs are going to be collected and these are used for the patients who are suffering with major ailments like heart and kidney failures. So these are transplanted to the recipients. So you have learned about the kidney, the chief excretory organ of our body. So only the kidney is the excretory organ in our body? No. So remaining along with the kidney, some of the remaining organs are also which are helpful for the excretion in the human body. So what are the other excretory organs of human body? So they are lungs, skin, liver and large intestine. And you have studied about lungs and large intestine in your previous chapters. In the previous chapters of nutrition and the respiration, you have studied about how the lungs helpful for the excretion, and the large intestine in the nutrition lesson, the digestion topic, you have learned how the large intestine play a major role in the removing of waste material from our body after the digestion. So this, once again, I'm going to repeat it for you. So other pathways of excretion is here, these are lungs, you know, the expelling of CO2 is going to be taken place, which are released by the cells. The cells, after metabolic activities, they release CO2. That CO2 is going to be released by the, so entered into the alveoli. So from that, it is going to be entered out of the body by using lungs. And the next here it is skin. So skin is also a excretory organ. So subsidiary excretory organs, these are. Lungs help in respiratory process. Lungs remove carbon dioxide and water from the body. So excess amount of carbon dioxide and the water which is present in the body is going to be removed by the lungs. And next, skin. The skin is consisting of large number of sweat glands richly supplied with blood capillaries, from which they extract sweat and some metabolic waste. So whatever the metabolic waste which are present in the in the body that is going to be expelled out through the skin also in the form of a sweat. The sweat glands are responsible. They are richly supplied with blood capillaries. So whatever the impurities which are present in the blood, that is reached into the sweat glands. From the sweat glands, it is released in the form of sebum and also some amount of salts. Okay. So this is the lungs and skin are the excretory organs. The sebaceous glands in the skin eliminate sebum. So in the form of sebum, it is going to be eliminated, and also in the form of salts. And these are going to be eliminated. The waste material is going to be eliminated. The sebum, which contains waxes, sterols, hydrocarbons, and fatty acids. So this skin eliminates sebum. So this sebum is containing waxes, so waste material which are not required for the body. So sterols, hydrocarbons, and fatty acids. And next, you can see the liver. And so large intestine, lungs, and here this is skin and kidney. So all these four are, you have to remember, they will be asking large intestine, this is lungs and skin and kidneys. These are involved in excretion of the waste material from our body. So how the liver will be helpful for the excreting the products which are not useful for the body. So liver produces bile pigments, that is bilirubin and bilirubin and urochrome. So these bile pigments, the liver is going to produce the bile pigments bilirubin, bilirubin and urochrome, which are metabolic wastes of hemoglobin of dead RBCs. So the spleen is the part where the death of the RBC is going to be taken place. So it reaches, so where these waste, metabolic waste of hemoglobin of dead RBC is going to be removed by the liver by in the form of bilirubin, bilirubin and urochrome. The lifespan of RBC, you know, in the 9th standard you have studied the lifespan of RBC is 120 days. They are, after that they are going to be destroyed in the liver, and urochrome is eliminated through urine. Bilirubin, bilirubin are excreted through the bile along with the cholesterol and derivatives of steroid hormones. So these bilirubin and bilirubin, they are excreted. So these are going to be excreted with the undigested material. So whatever in the digestive system, at last the excretion is going to be happen. Along with that excretory products, bilirubin and bilirubin is also going to be released, and urochrome is eliminated through urine. So these the death of the RBC is going to be taken place. The death of the RBC is in the form of bilirubin and bilirubin and urochrome. So next, liver involved in urea formation. So liver is also playing a major role over here. And next, large intestine. Excess salts of calcium, magnesium and iron are excreted by epithelial cells of colon. Already you have studied this. Excess amount of salts, magnesium, calcium and iron are excreted by epithelial cells of large intestine, and along with the elimination, it is going to be taken place along with the feces, means fecal matter, along with the fecal matter. Some amount of nitrogenous waste are also eliminated through saliva and tears. So still remaining any excess amount of salts are there, that is going to be released through saliva and tears. I think you have understood what are the organs which are helpful for the excretion. Main organ which is responsible for excretion is kidney, after that lungs. So lungs, skin, liver, large intestine, these are also the organs which play a major role in the excretion of our body. So the excretory system for different organisms are different. So here you can see the evolution of excretory system. In lower organisms, single-celled organisms are there, multicellular organisms are there. In the single-celled organisms are also excretion should be happen. So why? Because the waste material should not be inside the cell. So what it has to do, it has to eliminate from the cell of a particular organism. So what are the things which are used for the different organisms use a different excretory system for removal of waste material? You can see here protozoa. Protozoa in the excretory system, it uses simple diffusion from the body surface into the surrounding water. So they use simple diffusion from the body surface, and the diffusion is the process it can able to remove waste from the body surface into the surrounding water. And porifera and sealant are, they they show water beds almost all they sell. So here they their cells are in water beds by the body walls. They can able to excrete the materials. So next, platyhelminthes and nematoda. First excretory organ, the flame cells are going to be observed in the platyhelminthes and nematoda. Here you can see the platyhelminthes tapeworm. So there you can see, and nematoda and platyhelminthes, you can see the excretory system cells are called flame cells. Most of the time, many examinations, means competitive examinations, for competitive examination, this table is very much necessary. So how the excretion is going to be happened in platyhelminthes? By using the flame cells. And how the excretion should be taken place in annelids? So example for annelids is earthworms. So earthworms, the excretion is happening by using the nephridia. So nephridias are the structures, so by the help of nephridia, annelids can excrete the material out of the body. And next, arthropoda uses green glands and malpighian tubules for the excretion. So arthropoda means insects. You are going to observe mosquitoes, houseflies, all these are belonging to arthropoda. So they use green glands and malpighian tubules. And mollusca, they use metanephridia for excretion. And echinodermata, they use water vascular system. Reptiles, birds, and mammals, they use kidneys for the excretion of the waste material. Once again, this is very, very, very important. You have to know these lower organisms and the higher organisms, how they go for excretion. So excretion is the one of the metabolic process where the excretion has to be happened in every cell. Otherwise, the toxic materials will be whatever the toxic material which are produced by the different metabolic activities will be present inside the cell itself, and it makes that toxic to the cell, and the death of the cell is going to be happen. Not to undergo the death of the cell, the functioning of the cell must be in a proper way. For that reason, the cell has to excrete waste material from the cell. So that is going to be taken place by all the organisms are go for excretion. So most of the lower organisms, they use simple diffusion process from the body surface. The excretory materials are to be released from the body surface. And if you take the porifera and coelenterates, so water bath is almost all their cells. And platyhelminthes and nematoda, they use flame cells. So many times this question has asked, so what are the excretory organs in nematoda and platyhelminthes? They may give example, nematoda example or platyhelminthes example, they will be asking what are the excretory organs. So especially tapeworms, you can roundworms, tapeworms, they will be using with cells, flame cells. And annelids, they use nephridia. Arthropoda, they use green glands and malpighian tubules. And mollusca, they use metanephridia. And echinodermata, they use water vascular system. And reptile, birds, and mammals, they use kidneys for excretion of waste material out of the body. So different organisms, excretion in other organisms, different organisms use various strategies in excretion. Specific excretory organs are absent in unicellular organisms. So what they do, these organisms remove waste products by simple diffusion from the body surface into the surrounding water. Freshwater organisms like amoeba, paramecium possess osmoregulatory organelles. So you have seen amoeba and paramecium structure. So in that osmoregulatory organelles called contractile vacuoles are present. They helpful for the buoyancy and also excretion. So it collects water and waste from the body, swells up and reaches the surface and bursts to release its content outside. The main excretion takes place through the body surface. So in lower organisms, excretion is going to be taken place by using the body surface by the process of diffusion. And if you take the multicellular organisms, They possess different excretory organs for removal of waste material from the body. Structural and functional complexity of excretory organs increases from sponges to humans. Evolution is going to be taken place from lower organisms to higher organisms. Sponges and coelenterates do not have specific excretory organs as water bathes almost all their cells. So next, excretory structures appear for the first time in flatworms. Platy helminthes are known as flame cells. Very, very important. As I have said, so sir, shall I continue? Sir, excretion in plants. So the excretion in plants is human beings and all the organisms, the plants are also organisms. So the plants excrete waste material from the plant body. So plants are also containing cells. They should also excrete waste material. So they excrete waste material from the cells. So excretion in plants also should be happen. So plant is also made up of with the cells. So do plants excrete like animals? So we are amazed to answer such type of questions. You are aware that a variety of end products are formed during metabolism and these nitrogenous wastes are important. So plants does not have specific organs to excrete these wastes. So plant break down waste substances at much slower rate than in animals. Plants do excrete, but they don't have specific organs to excrete. So they go for the accumulation of waste taken place. And these green plants in darkness and plants that do not possess chlorophyll produce carbon dioxide and water as respiratory waste products. So the respiratory waste products are also produced by the plant. And they will be, if you take the green plants, so they do not possess, in darkness and plants that do not possess chlorophyll produce carbon dioxide and water as respiratory waste products. Here, oxygen itself can be considered as a waste product generated during photosynthesis. In the process of photosynthesis, oxygen is going to be produced by the plant cells that is going to be come out of the plant cell and that exit outside through stomata of leaves and lenticels of stem. Here, the oxygen itself is a waste material for the plant. So that oxygen which is going to be generated in the process of photosynthesis that is going to be expelled out of the plant cell by using the stomata from the leaves and the lenticels of the stem. So these excretion releases the substances in plants. Do plants excrete like animals? Yes, the plants are also going to be excreted like animals, but these excretory organs are not present. So whatever the excess material is there, so they can get rid of excess water by a process like transpiration and guttation. And waste products may be stored in leaves, bark and fruits. When these dead leaves, bark and ripe fruits fall off from the tree, these waste products in them are get rid of. So whatever the products which are excess to the plant that is stored in the leaves, bark and fruits, so these are going to be eliminated from the when these leaves or dead leaves, so these dead leaves, bark and ripened fruits are fall off. So wastage gets stored in the fruits in the form of solid bodies called rhaphids. So this is also one of the question. So waste gets stored in the fruits in the form of solid bodies called rhaphids. So this is the these solid bodies of the waste which are present in the fruits is called rhaphids. So, however, several compounds are synthesized by the plants for their own use, especially for defense. So, some the plants produce, synthesize some of the products which are useful for the protection of the plants. So, especially for defense. So, defense means for protecting themselves. So, they use these plants synthesize chemicals and they store in the roots, leaves and seeds. So, for protection against herbivores. Herbivores means the organisms which feed upon the plants. So, especially green plants. So, what it will do? The plants are also having defense mechanism where it produces some of the chemicals like harmful chemicals which are stored in the roots, leaves and seeds. So due to that reason, the herbivores can't eat that one. If it eat, what happened? So the waste material is, these also can be removed from the plant. So most of the chemicals are unpleasant to taste. So herbivores usually do not prefer to eat such plants. Some of the chemicals are toxic and may even kill the animal that eats them. So this is the defense mechanism of the plant. So think and discuss here. Why are weeds and wild plants not affected by insects and pests? So why are weeds and wild plants? So wild plants, they are not affected by insects and pests. So why? Because they have the defense mechanism. Okay, shall I close, sir?
245
అడిగాను సార్ నేను. ఓకే సార్. సో బై దిస్ వీ కెన్ సే దాట్ ద ప్లాంట్స్ ఆర్ ఆల్సో గోయింగ్ ఫర్ ఎక్స్క్రీషన్ అండ్
నెక్స్ట్ అది ఇవ్వాలి లింక్.
థ్యాంక్ యూ సో మచ్ ఫర్ లిజనింగ్ దిస్ క్లాస్.